welcome to Ireland AM. It is the 23rd of September. A happy Friday.
Here comes the weekend. Now, coming up this morning, we take a look at the big stories making the news, including Micheál Martin's condemnation of the Russian invasion of Ukraine at the UN.
We'll look ahead at the weekend sport, including the big night for Stephen Kenny and Ireland in Glasgow.
The Irish Amputee football team are en route to the World Cup, but before they leave, they're stopping by to tell us all about their World Cup chances.
And she was absolutely massive in the 90s and the early noughties. Grammy Award-winning singer and I Try hit maker Macy Gray joins us to talk about being bullied in school because of her voice and being starstruck working with Denzel Washington.
The hit maker herself. And she shot to fame after winning the Great British Bake Off in 2015. Nadiya Hussain will be here talking about life after Bake Off and how her kids really don't care that her ma's on the telly.
But of course, the biggest star of the moment is not Macy Gray. It's of course our Derek. He's the man in the know about the weather this morning. Derek, where are you this morning?
Good morning, guys. We're live here in Leixlip in County Kildare. Well, Elaine, it's a little bit sunny. Well, it's sunny actually for Saturday with good bright spells. And cloudy for Sunday with some scattered showers. And out there today, in fact, a pretty decent one in store with some rain through eastern and southeastern parts. But I mean, following all the heavy rain we had yesterday, it bucketed down on air. I got soaked through my jacket, my socks, my jocks, the whole lot. I was destroyed. So it's drier this morning. That's a little bit of good news.
It's Friday, yeah. We'll try you out. Get out the hairdryer. Forget Macy Gray. It's looking a little grey in Leixlip this morning.
Oh, great. Good morning.
It's going to be a long morning, lads. I'm here till 10.
Buckle in.
Let's go over to the Virgin Media News Hub now, and here's Hannah Murphy.
Thank you and good morning. A woman in her 40s has appeared before Mullingar District Court charged with the murder of her two children. 5-year-old Thelma and her 2-year-old brother Michael Denany were fatally injured after a car fire in Multifarnham 2 weeks ago.
Lynn Eager appeared before Judge Bernadette Owens here at Mullingar District Court shortly before 8 p.m. Detective Sergeant David Donnelly gave evidence of arrest charge and caution. The Garda said the 48-year-old of Winetown, Rathone in County Westmeath made no reply when charged with 2 counts of murder. She is accused of the murder of her children, Thelma and Michael Denany, at Lacken, Multifarnham in Westmeath on September 9th last. Thelma, aged 5, and her younger brother Mikey, who was aged 2, were fatally injured when their vehicle went on fire. Miss Eager, who was dressed in a wine top, did not address the court during the brief hearing. Legal aid was granted. The judge remanded the mother in custody to the Doka Centre, the women's section of Mountjoy Prison, to appear before Athlone District Court next week.
Taoiseach Micheál Martin has addressed the United Nations General Assembly in the US, where he accused Russia of behaving like a rogue state. He also raised concerns about the devastating impacts of climate change and the threat of global food insecurity. Our news correspondent Zara King has this report from New York.
Well, Taoiseach delivered an impassioned speech here at the United Nations in New York overnight when he spoke directly about the war in Ukraine. He said, "We have to name what we are seeing. These actions, taken collectively, show Russia as behaving as a rogue state." Micheál Martin taking the opportunity during this speech to speak about his own experiences visiting the war-torn country and the impact the war is having on civilians, men, women and children. He said, "Where Russian forces have pushed back, we see destruction, the uncovering of mass civilian graves, giving the example of Bucha." The Taoiseach also taking the opportunity during this speech to highlight the successes that Ireland has had as a member of the UN Security Council, including things like peacekeeping missions, ensuring that humanitarian aid continues to get to millions of people in Syria, something that happened earlier this year. But the Taoiseach also pointed to the fact that they have been disappointed at times with the UN Security Council. He said that particularly when it came to the issue of climate change, he said that it had been somewhat disappointing. He said it frankly beggars belief that in 2022, he said, the UN body charged with the maintenance of peace and security has still not taken on its responsibilities in the area of climate change. He said it is a singular failure of political will and political responsibility.
And four occupied regions of Ukraine will today vote on whether they want to join Russia. The Moscow-engineered referendums will open to those living in Luhansk, Donetsk, Kherson and Zaporizhia. It's seen as laying the groundwork for Russia to annex the regions in a sharp escalation of the invasion and follows a successful counteroffensive from Ukraine earlier in the month. The five-day vote, which was only announced on Tuesday, will not have independent monitors, leaving ample room for a rigged outcome. Residents of Bermuda and Canada have been readying themselves for the wrath of the Category 4 Hurricane Fiona. It's already caused extensive damage across the Dominican Republic and devastated many communities in Puerto Rico, where eight people have also been reported dead. The storm is due to pass over Canada late tonight or early in the morning. Yesterday, residents in Bermuda were warned to prepare for life-threatening conditions along the coast as the storm made its way there in the evening time.
So we want residents to please take this storm seriously. In that regard, I am urging residents, motorists and commuters to please be off the roads by 10 p.m. tonight.
And there'll be a celebration of Irish creativity today for the 17th Culture Night. Organisers say more than 1,700 events will take place in cities, towns and villages across the country this evening. That will include free music gigs, art classes, history tours and film screenings, with many venues staying open later than usual for the occasion.
For car insurance, van insurance or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
Thank you, Hannah, and a very good morning to you at home or if you're watching us online on the player. We're coming to you live here from lovely Leixlip in Kent Kildare here this morning. We're going to be broadcasting from the Scorers Heritage 10 over the next 3 hours. So if you're in the snack, those, we're actually on Main Street at the moment, so do pop by and say hi. We'd love to see you. Anyway, let's take an opening look at weather together now with Alan Fraser with us on cameras this Friday morning. And I have to say, following that heavy rain we had yesterday, a different start out there this morning. Much drier, much more settled, although we are seeing showers through parts of our man to Monaghan and County Donegal, but elsewhere a little bit of morning mist and fog now with some bright spells pulling through as we edge our way through the next couple of hours in that light northwesterly airflow. Now right across your Friday, in fact, pretty decent day. There's some nice bright spells kicking through. Again, some well-scattered showers across the country will nudge on the slightly heavier side through parts of Leinster and into the southeast. Top temps today of 14 to 17 degrees. And finally then tonight, mainly dry, calm and settled. So very similar to last night. Those winds completely taking the foot off the pedal from the northwest, and quite a chilly night in stores. Going to be quite cold for some parts, with values back to about 3 to 7 degrees. So that's how it's shaping up here in Leixlip at the moment. It's a cool autumn morning, so wrap up if you're out and about, and we'll catch you back live at 7:35.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell
of a quote. Stay with us. We're back with this morning's big news stories, including the latest from the UN as the world condemns the Russian invasion of Ukraine. See you in 3.
All right, welcome back. Now let's check on your morning newspapers, starting with the Irish Times this morning. And they lead with fresh calls for border poll in wake of NI census results. There were fresh calls yesterday to plan for a referendum on Irish unity following the release of census results that revealed Catholics now outnumber Protestants in Northern Ireland for the first time in its history.
Dire warning over housing plan as key targets missed. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. Cabinet ministers have been warned that the government's landmark plan to address the housing crisis is missing key targets and will not deliver the number of properties needed to address the long-running property supply problem.
The Examiner leads with crisis bill for families in need soaring. The government has been forced to hike emergency payments to families struggling with the cost of essentials such as clothes and housing.
Onto the tabloids now, the Daily Mail leads with Ardesh fear for Fianna Fáil. Concern is growing in Fianna Fáil over support for the party with abysmally low numbers, and members have registered to attend its Ardesh in a week's time.
The Star has thick talkers. Yobs behind the ramming of a Garda car have provided detectives with evidence to nail them by uploading snaps on TikTok.
And the Herald leads with mum charged with car blaze murders. A woman has been charged with the murder of her children, Mikey and Thelma Dennehy, in a car fire in County Westmeath.
The Sun lead with that same story. Their headline, blaze kids mum on double murder rap there. And joining us to discuss today's top stories is Deputy Political Editor with the Irish Independent and Sunday Independent, Hugh O'Connell. Hugh,
good morning.
Thanks for joining us. Good morning.
How are you?
Good morning.
Micheál Martin, well, Ukraine is the biggest story in the world still, particularly over the last couple of days, with Micheál Martin speaking to the UN. We'll get to that in a second. But they're holding a series of referendums in regions of Ukraine to try and declare that they're Russian.
Yeah, so these are referendums that will be widely and are widely discredited. The results are a foregone conclusion. But no one will recognise them outside of, I think, Russia.
Yeah.
So these are in four regions of Ukraine, Luhansk, Donetsk, Zaporizhzhia and Kherson. I think together they make up about 15% of the overall Ukrainian population. The referendums will take place this weekend. I think the voting will finish on Tuesday. But again, the result is a foregone conclusion. I'm not sure what the percentage will be, but I think it'll be pretty high, but it won't be a credible result. And I think it's been internationally condemned, widely condemned, and comes at the time when Vladimir Putin has obviously been escalating his rhetoric and Russia calling up a lot of young men, who many of whom are trying to flee the country to avoid getting involved in what is a pretty devastating war for Russia now at this stage. Volodymyr Zelensky, the Ukrainian president, has said, I think, that 55,000 Russians have died as a result of this war. Now, the credibility of that figure, I don't think we know, but certainly I think Russia has had a very bad war and it's been pushed back, and that's why Putin is responding in this way.
And it's not getting any better. No. In terms of those referendums, would there be a certain sympathy in some regions, particularly in the east of Ukraine?
I think so. I mean, I think there are some people in the east of Ukraine who do believe that they should be part of Russia and want to be part of Russia. But the point is that Russia illegally invaded these regions, has annexed them, and is behaving in a manner that is totally at odds with what we would expect in kind of peacetime, you know. So that's why we're in this awful situation. That's why you have the Taoiseach amongst several other international leaders condemning it at the UN overnight.
Yeah, and of course,
describing their actions as that of a rogue state.
And of course, his role now as Ireland's member of the Security Council actually puts it front and centre to the condemnation, really.
Yeah, no, it does. And, you know, that term is coming to an end now at the end of this year. It's been a 2-year term on the UN Security Council, I suppose, at a time when I don't think Ireland would have expected that this might have happened, and that this would be centre stage of the UN Security Council's deliberations. But it has been, and I think Ireland has been sort of to the forefront of trying to drive change in that area. But, you know, the UN Security Council is structured in such a way that Russia has a permanent veto. Russia is a permanent member, has a veto, and that has meant that the UN Security Council hasn't been able to do the work that perhaps others would like it to do in this space.
And huge news as well yesterday and overnight, of course, is the news of the Northern Ireland census, that there are more Catholics than Protestants for the first time since the formation of that Northern Ireland. So tell us the ramifications of that, because they are quite far-reaching.
Yeah, they are. I mean, it's not unexpected. This was widely expected. I mean, the figures have changed only slightly in the last 10 years in terms of the sort of flipping of the majority from Catholic to Protestant. It's 46-44, I think,
8%
10 years ago. Yeah, I think 10 years ago it was kind of 48% Protestants, or identified as Protestant from Protestant background, 45%. Catholic. So the ramifications are unclear, I suppose, at this point, but a lot of people are pointing to another figure that came out of that census yesterday, or figures that came out of that census yesterday, which is that 32% of people in Northern Ireland identify as British, 29% as Irish, and 20% as Northern Irish.
So that's it, you see.
It's this fragmentation. It is more nuanced. It's this fragmentation, three kind of distinct groups of people. You know, so people who obviously want a border poll as soon as possible will use yesterday's census results to bolster that argument and say that, look, the permanent Protestant majority, or that, you know, Northern Ireland was established for the reason of in maintaining a permanent Protestant majority, which is now gone. But equally, we shouldn't read too much into the results to say that it's a mandate for a border poll. But certainly it will bolster the argument of those who want a border poll. Others will argue that it's not so simple. And you know, people are no longer identifying, merely their religious background is no longer informing their political views the whole time.
That's interesting.
So
it's
much more nuanced. It's a difficult.
And I suppose
it's going to lead to a lot more debate, I think, you know.
Reflecting the whole passport issue up there, so many people in Northern Ireland of all persuasions have been applying for Irish passports.
They have.
And that has been, I suppose, informing a lot of people's opinion on this. But it can mean very little. It can be for economic and social reasons as well. If you look like college attendance within the Republic of Ireland, and of course abroad, the freedom of travel, all these sort of things. So that can't actually not normally
automatically lead on.
No.
And they feel European.
A lot of people, I think, are applying for Irish passports because they're a good thing to have in circumstances where the UK has
left. Not because they feel Irish.
But the UK has left the European Union, so it's losing a lot of access to the European single market, for freedom of travel across Europe, freedom to work, freedom to do all sorts of things that they cannot do if they're just British citizens alone. So people are taking up that opportunity to apply for an Irish passport. But look, this is going to be something that's going to be debated now in the next few years ahead. And I think it is going to bolster the argument of those pushing for a border poll. But I think equally unionists will point out that it's a lot more complex than that.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's going to move the dial too much in terms
of slowly, as the dial continues to move. We'll be watching the next figures in another 10 years' time or whenever they come out again. Also, big story this morning. The Housing for All plan, missing targets. They want more, they need more money, or a call for more money.
Yeah, it's pretty extraordinary, really, because this is a €4 billion a year plan that Dara O'Brien has had, the housing minister, an unprecedented level of investment in housing provision in this country. And this damning memo that was obtained by my colleague Philip Ryan in the Irish Independent today shows that the government's missing all their targets, or a lot of their targets, really. And in a situation, I think, where, you know, anecdotally and even the statistics are showing this, an awful lot of landlords are getting out of the market now, which is causing a massive crisis within the rental sector. Mm-hmm. Homelessness is at record levels. So there's this feeling now that the government's not got on top of this housing problem at all. It's been obviously problematic in terms of the Ukrainian refugee crisis. That's put pressure on the system as well. But there really is a feeling, I suppose, that the government isn't getting on top of this now, and this is
and specifically, what targets are they missing?
Those targets are impacted. They're not getting as many houses built as they thought they would, and they're not, I suppose, having an impact in a way that is.
Yeah, they need
beneficial to people.
Yeah, we all do. Yeah. All eyes will be on the upcoming budget as well to see what they're going to do for renters, what they're going to do for landlords to keep them in the market. I mean, there was calls last week for them to reduce the tax on rental income. I mean, it's not a one size fits all here. There's so many measures that need to be
looked at. There's so many measures
to just stem the flow of the exodus from the rental market, which of course is having huge ramifications for the housing crisis because people can't get access.
No, I mean, I think if you look at this time last year, I think there was 2,000 something properties on daft.ie, and now there's 700. So I mean, the market is completely skewed now in such a way that it's massively problematic to get rental accommodation, particularly in Dublin. And that's something that the government's pledged to address, wanted to address, is trying to address. But now you're going to see more measures probably announced in the budget next week. Dara O'Brien looking for more money to try and address this crisis. Yeah. But again, people are looking at it and they're thinking, the government cannot get a handle on this. They're 2 years into their
much
term.
Longer, yeah.
So it's a massive political problem for the coalition.
Not even in Dublin now. I mean, back where I'm from in Cork during the week, I know a couple of families living in hotels in a country area that normally you'd never see things like that happening. And it's just, it's countrywide now at the moment. Yeah. But we're going to finish on somewhat of...
this is great news for parents. This is fantastic news. We can continue to raise your kids for you.
Can be good for your children.
Yeah.
Plonking them in front of the telly is not all bad.
We would say that, though, in fairness.
Well, we're not saying it. It's in a study, so it must be true.
It's confirmed. This is for those of us thinking, Jesus, too much screen time, you can't be leaving the kids in front of the telly. Actually, if you watch it with them, is that
right? Yeah, and you talk to them about it and you encourage them, I think. Look, my attitude to this is everything in moderation, right? So a little bit of telly doesn't harm anyone, I don't think. So I'm definitely in favour of this.
Yeah.
And it's great news, I think. You know, it's research from the University of Portsmouth in Paris, Nanterre University. And it's showing, I think, something that all parents would be delighted to see this morning, that a little bit of telly for their kids and watching it with them, which they might not like to do, but they can always go on their phone, I suppose.
SpongeBob isn't too bad.
SpongeBob is the word. In the Night Garden, raise my kids. Get your kids to bed every night. It was absolutely incredible. Fantastic, yeah. And during the pandemic, it was mostly Netflix and this. Virgin Media Television. Hugh, thanks very much for joining
us. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much.
By the way, don't be using that as a carte blanche now to stick them in front of the screen all the time. read the study results first before you actually...
Age-appropriate stuff.
...plonk them down. Yeah.
No family guy.
Yeah. Or you can leave them with us for the rest of the morning at 10 o'clock. We'll look after them for you, don't worry. You just pour them a bowl of cereal. Let us know what you think on that. You can text us for free on WhatsApp. The number is 0896... 111111.
You can, of course, email irlandam@virginmedia.ie.
And you can find us at IrelandAMVMTV on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. Stay with us. We've got sport coming up after the break.
You're very very welcome back. Now, next month we have an Irish team to be cheering about, and that's because the Irish amputee football team are taking on the World Cup in Turkey.
So joining us now to talk about the team's chances are the manager, Christy McElligot, as well as team captain James Conroy and rising star Jack Douglas. Gentlemen, thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
It's very early for training, isn't it?
Very early for training, very energetic altogether. And I love what we're doing there, because we're actually going to illustrate how the rules work in a second. But first, Christy, can I ask you, amputee football, how did you get involved in the first place? And can you explain to us what it actually is and what the rules are? Because I have to say, they baffled me when I was reading up about it. So we have the lads to show us.
Yeah, I think, first of all, I got involved many years ago. A good friend of mine, Simon Baker, set up the Irish Amputee Football Association and had an event with an ex-colleague of mine, the FBI, Hussain Jordan. And I went and had a look at it and I decided to get involved. I was a bit apprehensive at first because I wasn't sure whether it was for me, but when I seen the lads playing, they asked me to take my leg off and get involved and just play. And they said, I'm not too sure. And Simon, of course, as Simon is, he pushed me into it and really pushed me into it. And I got involved in it there on the day and I never looked back. That was over 14 years ago. So.
And when you say they asked you to take your leg off, you're actually not allowed to use your prosthetics in this if you're actually playing.
Yeah.
So we'll actually illustrate what the lads are doing there now. So the rules are your residual limb, is that you just take it out completely.
Yeah, so if you're not an outfield player with one leg, you're not allowed to wear your prosthetic. So the leg that the prosthetic goes on is called your residual limb.
Yeah.
So the leg that you do have, your standing leg, you play on crutches, and you're not allowed underarm crutches, so we use the aluminium crutches here.
So if you see what Jack is doing here, so he's not allowed to use in any way, shape or form, he's not allowed to use that other limb. So it's like a handball in one of the mill football.
So if we use the crutches at all to control the ball or gain an advantage, that's handball, so because it's an extension of his arm, so he's not allowed to use the crutches. Somebody kicks the ball off the crutches while they're planted in the ground as they are now.
Yeah, go on, yeah.
Yeah. And then it's okay because it's in a natural position.
It wasn't deliberate.
Yeah.
Right, okay, I got you. It must involve incredible dexterity to be able to go, as well as controlling yourself, you've got the crutches to be mindful of as well all the time.
Yeah.
And the inclination you might be to go to give it a swipe or to give it a puck or whatever. Tell us about James then as well, because James isn't missing.
James is missing his hand. So,
but then that's allowed in certain circumstances.
That's allowed. Yeah. So you can be you can go from the wrist, the elbow, or the shoulder.
Right. Okay.
And in them circumstances, if you're going from the wrist, the arm has to be tucked in. You're not allowed to use it at all to gain an advantage. If you're going from the elbow, it's the same. And if you're going from the shoulder, you don't need to tuck it in because
I'm going to go over to James. I want to go over and have a chat with you, sir. How are you? He's coming over to me. I'm in the middle of training. I'm too early for this. Yeah. How did you get him? GAA was your sport originally, wasn't it?
Well, I'm from Screen and Mead, and GAA is king out there. So it's a long story. I always played soccer as well, mainstream soccer. But one day in 2013, I was at a bus stop in Dunchocklin.
Yeah.
And Christy McElligot drives by.
Your man over there. Because he was saying he needed to be bullied into it. Did you have the same experience?
Big time, yeah.
Really?
So he hit the brakes, reversed inside, one hand. He got talking to me. He said he had one leg and didn't want to play amputee football. And to me, sounded a bit out there. And it was like I was playing soccer and Gaelic in mainstream sports. So I wasn't too keen at the start, to be honest. Eventually, a bit of pressure, he took my number. And after about 6 months, I went down. I haven't looked back.
Jesus, your man again. Another missed call.
Exactly. I said I'd go down once just to keep him happy and get him off my back. And it's taken over my life.
And he's a big guy to have on your back as well.
He is.
To be doing.
Absolutely, yes.
Tell us then, you're the captain, right?
I am.
So your experience, you're performing, I was saying, in terms of dexterity and fitness, it must be nearly a full-time job, is it?
I suppose.
Big commitment.
We train like the inter-county footballers at times, 6 days a week, up before work, do a bit of training, come home, have a bit of dinner, go training as well and stuff. So it is, you're pushing yourself against the best athletes in the world at your sport. So if you want to go and give it everything, you have to take it
seriously.
What
do you do for a living?
I'm an IT instructor with the National Learning Network in Navan, which is rehab, the education branch of rehab.
So you've to go to, are you going to work today?
My boss was nice enough to give
very
me a few hours off this morning, so I'm going in around 12 o'clock.
Well, that's the thing, but then you've got training and you've got to balance it all in the entire
absolutely,
time.
Absolutely, yeah.
Which is fair play. And then in terms of our prospects then, as you're heading to Turkey, how are we feeling?
Yeah, we're feeling good. We've never had a stronger squad, training's gone really well. We've a good group of lads. We finished, 8 years ago we finished 19th, then 4 years ago we finished 13th, so I suppose our goal is probably to improve on that and, yeah. and to show progression and see how far we can go then, you know.
Right, okay. Let me go over to, I want to go over and have a chat with Jack. Rising
Jack
star.
Here, of course. He's described. He's the youngest.
Yeah.
The youngest
the
player on the team.
Yeah.
No pressure there.
No pressure at all, no. Please God.
So now, tell us, you became an amputee relatively recently compared to the lads here. What has the sport done for you? Because I think it's important to emphasise the camaraderie and what I can do kind of for your head as well, because it's not the easiest thing to come to terms with. Tell us about that.
Oh, sure. I was a young lad and I thought I'd get nowhere in life with being disabled and get talking to lads and you make you feel better and feel normal about being disabled and show everyone what you can do being disabled. And
yeah. And what happened to you in the first place, do you mind my asking?
A lawnmower accident when I was 2 years old.
Two,
yeah.
Just a baby, yeah.
Yeah.
And would you ordinarily, Jack, regularly, when you're not playing, would you have a prosthetic that you'd be using the rest of the time?
Just walking around, I'd have the prosthetic
right.
on.
Okay.
But any other time, I'd be on the crutches.
Have you Googled what the weather's like in Turkey in October?
No. Not Googled, anyway.
Have you checked it out? Christy, have you checked out the weather situation? Because
I've
why is it going to need a bit of downtime as well, aren't
yeah,
they?
No, yeah, no, I've looked at it a small bit. It's in the 20s, like, so, and we've, in fairness, we've been to a lot of countries where it's been very warm. We've been to Mexico twice.
Right.
We've been to Turkey. This will be the second time to Turkey. So it's been very warm, and Poland has been very warm as well. So can't wait till we bring them to Ireland at some stage.
Yeah, well, it would be fun. Is there any indication that they might come to Ireland that we might
yeah,
see?
Yeah, well, look, we hope to host a couple of small tournaments maybe next year.
Right.
And try and give people an idea of what Ireland's really like.
Right.
Can I ask you about like what your hopes are for the actual sport itself? Because, I mean, it's relatively new compared to other ones. I mean, are we looking at Paralympics? Is that what you're hoping eventually?
I think the overall sport itself, from the Irish Amputee Football Association's point of view, and the FEI's, is around trying to gain Paralympic status,
yeah.
and that's the goal for the World Amputee and the European Amputee as well. We want to be recognised as a Paralympic sport.
Yeah.
We're not there yet. We think we're just missing a couple of areas that we need to include. And girls' football is definitely yeah. up there. And there's a lot of the European teams and the South American teams where girls' football teams already established. So it's something that we plan on looking at ourselves in the future. But yeah, definitely Paralympic sport is the way.
But from talking to the lads there, it's done such... it's great mentally for them as well to be involved with like-minded people who are feeling the same, the sense yeah. of camaraderie and the fun and the sense of purpose as well. There's a lot of people that could play and that aren't playing.
Yeah.
I suppose it's a call-out to them as well.
It is. I think, look, from our own point of view, we have our own national league here. We do with Bowes, Shamrock Rovers and Cork City playing and a team from Scotland who travel over to play.
Aye.
So for ourselves, from the grassroots point of it, it's really good that we have that football here for ourselves. We're also tailoring in such a way that we're producing our international players to compete at a high standard. The more players we get in the country to get involved, the better it's going to be for ourselves.
Cool. Christy, first game and first date. What date are we shouting?
Our first game is against Morocco on the 1st.
Morocco, come on, they'll be walking the
yeah,
path.
Well, we don't know enough about them, but we'll give it a go, as yeah. we always do, what all Irish teams do.
Yeah.
We're confident in our own ability to get a result, but, you know, football's strange, you know.
Right.
Never know what's going to happen.
No.
And
right.
I have to say, listen, the best luck. We'll all be cheering you on.
Guys.
And, of course, if you want to tune in to the lads when they're playing, all of the Irish teams' matches at the World Cup will be streamed live on YouTube, and you can find all the information on the website,
IrishAmputeeFootballAssociation.com. Don't kick it at me, Jake.
He can't do it.
I'll be the worst.
Anyway,
I'll be the worst representative. Right, we'll be right back.
Watch, he doesn't stand your toes.
After this quick break. Don't be coaching me at the same time, Jake. Come on, get me out of here, Jake. You're very welcome back. Now let's check on your morning papers. Starting with the Irish Times, they lead with fresh calls for border poll in wake of NI census results. There were fresh calls yesterday to plan for a referendum on Irish unity following the release of census results that revealed Catholics now outnumber Protestants in Northern Ireland for the first time in its history.
Dire warning over housing plan as key targets missed. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. Cabinet ministers have been warned the government's landmark plan to address the housing crisis is missing key targets and will not deliver the number of properties needed to address the long-running property supply problem.
The Examiner leads with crisis bill for families in need soaring. The government has been forced to hike emergency payments to families struggling with the cost of essentials such as clothes and housing.
On to the tabloids, the Daily Mail leads with Ardesh fear for Fianna Fáil. The concern is growing in Fianna Fáil over support for the party, with abysmally low numbers of members registered to attend its Ardesh in a week's time.
The Star leads with thick talkers. Not an easy one to say, this, Sarah. Thick talkers, yobs behind the ramming of a Garda car have provided detectives with evidence to nail them by uploading evidence on TikTok.
And the Herald leads with mum charged with car blaze murders. A woman has been charged with the murder of her children, Mikey and Thelma Denani, in a car fire in County Westmeath.
The Sun lead with the same story. Their headline, blaze kid's mum on double murder rap.
Now, there's plenty of time to reach us. You can text us for free on WhatsApp. The number is 0896 111 111.
You can email irelandam@virginmedia.ie.
And as always, you can find us at IrelandAM VMTV on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram.
Twitter.
Well,
Twitter's drop us a little tweet on the Twitter.
Powerhouse of R&B and soul, Macy Gray joins us. It's okay.
I try.
Macy Gray's here next.
Thank you.
We'll all try with Macy in a couple of minutes. That's me on the dart pulling faces at somebody else's child. We're very excited. She broke onto the music scene over 20 years ago with that global smash hit single, I Try. And she went from strength to strength, selling over an incredible 25 million albums worldwide to date.
Macy Gray is now back with a brand new album titled The Reset, which is out today. But before we chat to Macy, let's take a sneak peek at her latest single from the new album called Every Night.
I wanna reminisce on, yeah, where I'm coming from. I wanna feel you, baby. I wanna sing my song. We're gonna get all the way up to the sky, down in my soul, around the world, yeah, in my head. Here we go.
We're dancing, it's got us moving. Macy Gray, thank you so much for joining us this morning. How are you, madam?
I'm good, how are you? It's nighttime for me, but you know, good morning.
It's nighttime for you and early morning for us, but we're delighted to have you. And a big day today. The album is out today, putting it out into the world. It's certainly the single we were looking at there. It's joyous, it's happy, it's positive. Are you feeling all those today as we're finally getting to hear it?
Yes. Here's the thing. We pushed the album back. You're the first to know.
You pushed it back?
Yeah, the album lands on Valentine's Day, 2023, February 14th.
Oh, right. So that's just a recent decision then? So we're not going to get the full album today?
Yeah, like 5 minutes ago.
On what basis did you make that decision?
You know, Valentine's Day, you know, love and all that other stuff. No, honestly, we wanted to do some more things to the album, you know, make it more perfect for everybody. And then we got this new idea for the artwork. It's like, you know, I just want to make it like the greatest it can be. And we had a lot of ideas, like literally, you know, very recently. And we decided to push it back to.
That's the thing, isn't it? Like you're always tinkering, you're always fine-tuning, you're always perfecting. And before you want to put it out, you want it to be absolutely just right.
Yes, it's a great album, and we came up with this new song that we did with Big Frida, and we want to put it on the album. So we're gonna wait to get that song all set, and then we're going to release the album. Finally.
All right. Yeah. Well, we're looking forward to it. Perfect timing
as
well for Valentine's Day.
Because, of course, the whole thing about the reset, it's what everybody's been trying to do over the last a couple of years, really, because the whole world has changed hugely, and that's the pandemic, and writing, recording in a pandemic must have been quite challenging for you.
Yes, well, I've learned to look at the upside of the pandemic. You know, I think it put everybody in the same boat. You know, everybody, no matter where you're from, what you look like, was had to adjust, you know, and do things differently and learn different things. And so I think in that way it was good for us, because we all had to, you know, to refresh, you know, do things a little different and come up with new ideas and new ways to live and stuff like that. So and the album was created during that time, so it has a lot of that emotion, you know.
Yeah, I suppose you've evolved quite a lot over the years as well. Earlier on, of course, we saw your massive single, I'll Try, which, like, took the world by storm. But now, when we look at what you're doing now and the way you've such a unique voice, what you do with your voice, I mean, what influences you now as opposed to maybe 20, 30 years ago when you started in college and the jazz thing? Like, who do you look up to now for your inspiration?
Oh, that's a good question. I mean, I still really have the same influences. You know, your idols are always your idols. I think there's a lot of really great new artists. But, you know, the people that mentored you and taught you and got you where you wanted to go, those are always the same, you know. So, you know, I tell everybody I was really into Bob Marley and Steve Wonder, and I was a big Billie Holiday fan, and I listened to a lot of rock and roll. I was, you know, a huge groupie for Mick Jagger and all those, you know. So I have a lot of influences, but they're probably still the same 20 years later.
That's interesting. You gotta stay true to your originals, the originals and the greats. I read, Macy, that you were picked on. You, like Elaine mentioned, you have such a distinctive voice, a distinctive speaking voice, and you're singing unique, beautiful, gorgeous. But you were picked on as a kid for sounding different.
Oh yeah, they still pick on me. It still goes.
What? No.
I was just in the studio and they were just mocking me like 5 minutes ago. Yeah, I get people try to do like imitations of me all the time. It's hilarious. I should have a contest. I should have a, you know, like a, what do you call that? The X Factor for imitating my voice.
Yeah. Absolutely not. No, yeah. I think you've got a gorgeous voice, and it's clearly stood to you as well.
It's so unique, though. I think your voice is quite. Unlike anything I've ever heard before.
Thank you.
But in a beautiful way, because it is so unique. I mean, when we look at how hugely successful you've been, I mean, the whole one-hit wonder thing that's been bandied about, which is ridiculous considering the amount of albums you've sold, the amount of streams you get on the music platform, it's absolutely enormous. So that quality that you have is massively popular still.
I do pretty well for myself, yeah.
Pretty well for yourself. And it's not just the singing either, because many people may not know that you dabble in the acting as well. Tell us how that came about.
So I was in the studio, actually, a guy by the name of Antoine Fuqua walked in, and now he's a huge director, but he walks in and he says, you know, I'm doing this movie called Training Day, and I want you to be in it. And I thought he was crazy. I was like, why would you want me to be in it? I'm not an actress. I've never done it before. This must be stupid, you know. So I kind of blew him off for like a while. And then he invited me out to Mr. Chow's. And, you know, you always are down for a free dinner. So I went to that, and then we talked. And then we were just talking casually, and he mentioned that Denzel Washington was in it. And I didn't know that. So I was like, what? You know? And so then I thought, well, you know, I gotta be in this, because, you know, I'm a huge fan of Denzel. So I thought, I'll get on set, I'll take pictures with Denzel, I'll send them to my mom, you know. I'm thinking like that. I'm still not thinking I'm gonna be an actress. I didn't even know what he was talking about. So anyway, you know, but then I got in front of Denzel and I didn't want to make a fool of myself. So I got an acting coach and I, you know, I crammed and she really helped me get into the character and gave me kind of a crash, you know, acting course. But it was a small part anyway. So we got away with it. We did it. And then after that, I got, you know, other movies,
yeah,
other offers and stuff.
But yeah, talk about going in at the deep end for your first acting gig in front of Denzel. What, my God. And would you consider doing any more? Do you have any plans to do any further, or would you like to try more acting?
Yeah, I'm doing a movie in November. We're going to go on tour. We're going to do Europe for about a month. And then when I get back, I do a new film. I'm not supposed to say who's
okay. That's fine. No. We'll get you. Well, we want to get you back on again when the album comes out in February, so you can tell us all about the movie then as well. And you've done my God, I watch this show all the time with my kids, The Masked Singer, and every time,
yeah,
take it off, the hat comes off. I go, oh, that poor person, the sweat that must. Oh my God, you look fabulous there. Who? What were you?
I was supposed to be Atlantis.
Atlantis.
What?
Atlantis.
Yeah,
oh, Atlantis.
You know, Atlantis.
Sorry.
Wasn't Atlantis a mermaid or something?
Atlantis.
Sorry.
I don't even know. Anyway, that's supposed to be Atlantis.
Right.
They don't really, you kind of do all this prep and they show you and they say, so we have this idea for you to be Atlantis and you're going to look like this. And they kind of give you the feeling that you have options, but you really don't.
Like, okay.
You wear what they tell you to wear. Okay. But you weren't,
yeah,
at least you weren't wearing one of the big, huge plastic ones. It seemed, well, you correct me if I'm wrong, it looks a little bit more comfortable than some of the other ones you might see.
No, it was so uncomfortable. It's huge. It kind of sit, they had this kind of thing. It's really like engineering. It's really like crazy, the stuff they came up with, but it was like sitting on top of my head and I kind of had to balance it and it was heavy and it took 3 people to put it on, and then God forbid I had to go to the bathroom. That was just a disaster because you kind of,
and
it was huge.
Yeah, yeah. With your unique voice, I know that they disguise their voices. Did you have to put extra effort into, like, I don't want them to guess who I am, I'm going to totally change the way I sound?
Yeah, I tried that. The first time I went out and I said, I sang a song. What song was it? Anyway, I was trying to like disguise my voice, but I sounded kind of bad, and I almost got kicked off the first one. So I stopped doing that, and then I thought, oh well, they're gonna figure out who I am, but at least I won't sound so terrible. So then I go on, and the guy goes, I think that's Rihanna. He thought it was Rihanna.
Well, there you go. Just go, and perhaps you're one of her.
What'd you say?
I was going to say, perhaps you're one of her influences as well, which would be nice.
Yeah, exactly. So, No, I'm a huge Rihanna fan. I was flattered, but then I was like, what? And then one of them did say, I think that's Macy Gray. And then she goes, no, Macy Gray wouldn't be on this show.
That's the key. When the big star appears, it's like the hat comes off. It's always such a shocker. Macy Gray, the single is fantastic. It's called Every Night. And we keep an ear out for the album and for the new movie. Macy Gray, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
All right. Thank you, guys. Have a great day.
Cheers, Mrs. All the best. Bye-bye. And we'll be right back after this quick break.
You're welcome back. Now, there's definitely a chill in the air lately, so what better time to start thinking about investing in a new cosy coat? I feel seen. It's my favourite.
I know, but what's hot and what's not at the moment? Well, stylist Laura Jordan has the answers. I suppose what's not hot, what's warm, more to the
exactly.
point, that looks good as well, because we need to tick all the boxes.
We do, and I think with coats, we tend to put a coat on over our outfit thinking, well, the coat is the practical piece, and it covers the lovely items we might be wearing. So thinking about your coat as part of your outfit and as part of your lifestyle is a good starting point when you're deciding what purchases you're making for this autumn winter.
And a great investment piece as well, of course.
Absolutely. Cost per wear, as I'm always saying.
Cost per wear, I love that.
Is very, very high.
And of course, colour is huge again this season.
So when we look at a bright we have to talk about pink. It's the colour trend of this season. And this one in particular, that fuchsia, it works well with either black, white or bold tones underneath it. So pastel under that will wash it out slightly. It's a drop shoulder. It's that oversized look. And as a result, we have to put something quite streamlined underneath it. This is from Durbin's Fashions in Loughrea in Galway. Family-owned business and a huge selection both in-store and online. We've put this dress with it because you need to have contrast. An oversized coat needs a streamlined look underneath, whether that be skinny jean and t-shirt or polo neck or this streamlined dress that we've gone with it here.
And of course the jewellery as well, just very simple.
Just simple, and silver works better with these cooler tones. We usually try and put a silver with it. This is Betty and Biddy from their silver collection, the triple layer and then the trio star. And again with the neckline on this dress, you could put your jewellery underneath because it just would peak out beautifully, but we just said we want to make sure it was visible for this morning. And then this pencil shaped dress, it's a very good demure length, just at the knee, and it has a sleeve as well. I know you can't see it right now, but that's also a factor when you're purchasing, and again available online on their website as well as in the store. And the bag we've put with this here, that tweed Chanel effect,
very Chanel vibe.
What colours are in that now, because I can't see,
there's a bit of fleck of silver and then grey and black, so it's that kind of wool tweed finish with the silver hardware, which matches in with the belt and the jewellery, pulls it together nicely. And then the watch, which is a two-tone, is available all online at Fields Jewellers and through all of their stores in Ireland, so there's a good option there for gifting as well as for practical reasons. And then you want to go something not too over the top with the shoes. We've brought the silver again down to the feet with the block heel. These are Cordner shoes and available at shoeshop.ie, which is their website. So there's a practical on the go. That coat would work again, jeans, t-shirt, polo neck, Spanx, you know, all of the basic you have it up once it's streamlined because it's an oversized.
And it'll carry.
Absolutely, that's not going anywhere.
Yeah.
The vibrancy works.
Absolutely.
Very versatile piece here again with Ursula.
Yes.
Year in, year out, you wear that.
The trench or the Mac is really, if you said name a classic coat, it'll probably be at the top of the list. So this is a good option. And then it's got a little bit of contemporaneous. That denim jacket underneath is built in, so it's not layering to that level because it'd be very bulky.
Very clever.
If you're layering, you want to make sure that we do lighter fabrics close to the skin and thicker fabrics as we build out. So with this, to have that just at the front is helpful. And the taupe tone blends well with neutral. So you wouldn't necessarily put a bright with this. It needs that white, cream, beige, navy, those sort of, even the berry colours will work well, which we'll see in a second. In terms of the accessories, glasses from Mullingar Opticians, they have so many on their website and in the store there and in Enfield. And then the simple gold here to warm up that trench. So if we can kind of conceal the tortoiseshell buttons on the coat, are warm, you need to bring the jewellery along with it and all of the accessories kind of along the same thread. The shirt underneath, so simple and easy, your classic white shirt, which you might have in your wardrobe, where there's an option there if you don't or you want to upgrade it. And then same with just bringing it right down, the indigo jeans, streamline again. This would work with a tailored trouser too, and over a dress. A lot of times you'll see a max or trench worn in that way. This is how to wear it. More dressed down for the weekend just gives an easy cut with the shoulder, basically to what is jeans and a shirt. And then the bag here, this is that raspberry tone, that rich berry that works with that
autumnal colours are gorgeous.
Even a forest green would be lovely as well. And we'll see if the next bag would also work with this look. These are all from Jeremiah Higgins in Mayo, Ireland's oldest store, interesting, anecdotally, yes. And then the bracelet again from Betty and Biddy, blending in with the rope chain that we have there. So that's the way we kind of blend those colours, and the tan boot pulling it together. So again, keeping it easy, neutral, rich, deep, autumnal, rather than those statement colours we saw in the previous one.
Is that like showerproof? It looks perfectly. It looks really like showerproof.
It's got a sheen.
It's that coat you grab, isn't it? It's like that you think you'll get all the wear of it. Oh, look at the sleeve.
Yes. So we've gone for a statement sleeve here.
You're a bit of a fan of this look.
No, I like the sleeve.
When we look at last season, it was all about the statement shoulder. Now it's about the statement sleeve. So this is great. Some people say, oh my gosh, a statement shoulder will bulk me and make me wider. This allows you to wear that because it's on the sleeve as opposed to the shoulder. It still gives you your shape right at your shoulder. This is from Carrick Dunn. They have a huge selection on their website and through all of their stores throughout the country. This powder blue works beautifully on a cool skin tone, which Yumiko has. And underneath that, you have the bright colour in the dress here. And again, that wrap is a comfortable comfortable one, great for work, but also with all the colours in it. It's good for weekend or occasion if you've got something
very
coming
versatile
up as well.
Piece.
It really is. Got the three-quarter sleeve, the V-neck, the wrap to cinch in at the waist. So it ticks a lot of those functional shape mm-hmm. boxes in terms of something that's flattering. And then the glasses here again, I love that shape as contrast to the boxiness of the jacket, the circle finish there on those frames. Again, we've gone silver. Silver and blue work nicely together. So we've gone with the Celebrate collection, the earrings from Betty and Biddy, and the quote chain that's there on Yumiko's neckline. The bag, that green we mentioned, that would also look well with the trench, works nicely here, picks up the colours in the dress, again, from Jeremiah Higgins, and their pure leather pieces. And our Boss watch available via jewellers online and in their stores. And then the finishing point
cut
of this.
On those shoes.
This is
beautiful.
And we overlook that, don't we? The, yeah. the cut is so important on an ankle boot, or I call this almost a shoe boot. It cuts in under the ankle. It is a flattering finish on the leg, because as we move towards winter, it's harder to get flattering shoes that make our legs look leaner and longer when we pair them, particularly with dresses. So these guys are a navy option again.
I was just saying, navy.
Softer.
And when you, if you cut across the ankle there, it's just too, it's too harsh.
So harsh.
And you measure, you get cankles.
Yeah.
Let's
absolutely
talk.
Call you
a spade
do.
A spade.
Yeah, yeah. It's, when you try it and then on, you're sitting there going, yeah, well, that's where my legs up. These, by the way, these pink. Oh,
thank
I mean,
you.
They're the same.
Yeah.
See, pink instantly. Pepto-Bismol. Susie's in. Don't go anywhere. After the break, we'll be chatting to one of the greatest surfers Ireland has ever produced. Surf's up, Elaine.
Well, off with you. I'm not surfing. See you in three.
Welcome back. Now, most people's ideal trip to the beach involves floating and splashing around in nice shallow waters. The same can be said for our next guest, whose ideal day will be surfing the waves. And when we say waves, just the 50-foot, right?
Yeah, the odd 50-foot. 50-foot or more. That's right. From starting out in Bundoran to riding some of the biggest waves in Hawaii, our next guest, Richie Fitzgerald, has documented all of his amazing surfing adventures into a new book called Cold Water Eden. Richie, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.
Wait, you're from Bundoran?
Absolutely.
When I was a kid, going through Bundoran involved the arcades and the slot machines, and looking down at the beach and going, oh, God, it looks great. It looks tough down there. But when you were a kid, you were inside in it.
Yeah, and Bundoran today, you look at the arcades and look down on the beach at the same time, you know. But, yeah, I grew up there in a, you know, big family. We very much faced the sea, faced the ocean, and we were engaged, you know, in anything to do with the sea from the very get-go. And surfing was something that just followed on, swimming and running around the beach. So it was kind of hand in glove for us.
But surfing wasn't a thing, though, when we were kids, was it?
There was always surfers, or there had been surfers in Strandhill and Rosnaula, which are quite close to Bundoran.
Yeah.
You know, my family and my age group, we were the first generation of Bundoran surfers. But yes, it was minuscule in Ireland in the 60s, 70s and 80s. It really only started to catch fire in the 90s.
Yeah. So were you watching? How did that come about? Because obviously, as you say, you're facing the sea. Like, it seems like a natural thing that, like, now you'd say, well, you'd jump out and you'd surf. But it wasn't really then. So how did it come about? Like, were your parents surfing? Was anybody in the family? Like, was there someone in your mates watching something on MTV? Going...
No, not at all. My dad could barely swim and mom was only marginally better. So we got our encouragement and our passion for the sea from our older sister, my older sister, Frances. She was mad about swimming and surfing or anything she could get her hands on to go into the sea. And we'd bits of equipment, bad wetsuits, bad surfboards.
There was no supermarket selling wetsuits in those days.
No, absolutely not. So Francis and my older brother Joe pushed me into the first few waves. And I did hate it initially. But, you know, after 2-3 more surfs, I started to really like it. And I never looked back, really.
Got bitten by the bug.
Yes.
Yeah. Tell us about going pro. You were our first pro surfer. How did that come about?
Yeah, it sounds very grandiose, but I signed a professional contract with a company in 1996, but it was only really a couple of thousand pounds at the time per year with incentives. But I got my foot in the door and I built on that. And by, you know, 2007, 2008, I'd built up a very good portfolio as a professional big wave surfer, and it was financially viable then. But it did take me a long time.
When you say big wave, it is a different. From reading about it, it's not a matter of going
next
out or
level.
Even the surf competitions that you'd see.
Look at that!
Oh my God! Yeah. It's a very different discipline, isn't it?
Yeah, it's, you know, you can do surf lessons in La Hinch or Bundoran or Strandhill or wherever.
Yeah, regular surfing.
Which is 99.9% of people, but it's very different if you want to go out into, you know, waves that are 10, 20 foot up to 50 foot and beyond. It's a different mindset and you don't just jump into it. It's something that you have to build yourself up to, and we did and I did, and you either like that kind of thing or you don't.
Absolutely fearless to be
or
able
crazy.
To go. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. Like it's one or the other.
Or a bit of both.
Yeah. How do you find those waves? Do we have a lot of that around Ireland? Or, like, I know you've obviously gone out to Hawaii and surfed and across Europe, but do we have those conditions? Are they very rare? Or do you have to quite literally go out and chase that, that
no,
surf?
We're blessed in Ireland. We have an amazing array of surf on the West Coast, and we get a lot of storm systems pass through. So we get great regular surf, but we have an amazing amount of really good big wave spots all the way up the West Coast, especially in Clare and Sligo and Donegal. So they were there to be surfed, and I suppose my generation was the first to go out and surf them. But it's madness, as a friend of mine says. It's calculated madness, and there's nothing rational about it. And, you know, your self-preservation goes out the window. But, you know, I look at people climbing mountains that do it without ropes. I think, how do they do that?
And it's the same. Or those lads up on the skyscrapers as well without ropes and that kind of thing. It's similar. Just talking about, like, the actual, like you say, calculated...
Madness.
Calculated madness. Tell me about the calculations you have to do. Like, are you checking out the weather? Are you looking at, I don't know, storm fronts and that kind of thing? And then in terms of finding the wave, I mean, you need to be towed out to it, is that right?
Yeah, you know, there's paddle surfing and tow surfing, so you can do both. But some waves get so big that you physically cannot paddle fast enough to get onto them. So you use a jet ski to tow you in like a water skier.
Okay.
So it is a combination.
So you tow yourself to the fear.
Yeah.
Let's watch that wave come in on the back.
It's a combination of everything, just understanding the moods of the sea and knowing weather patterns and trusting yourself and your ability and the guys and girls that you're going out there with. Yeah. So it's a combination of all those things. It's not just one factor.
You've been injured. I can only presume, I mean, I've read the notes, but you've been injured. Does fear come into play, or can you not allow fear come in? Because to me, like, if the waves are in any way high, you know, when I'm paddling, like, I get nervous. Whereas you're actively seeking 20 foot, 30 foot, 50 foot, knowing what you know, that you can get injured, like you have been injured.
Yeah, it's just experience, and you use all that knowledge, but there's always that fear of injury. I haven't had too many bad injuries surfing. I've had a few, but it's just really if you've got to ride those consequences, and if you prepare as best you can and give yourself the best, you know, way going into the waves that you're not going to get smashed, well, hopefully you don't, but eventually you do. Everyone wipes out and everyone will get an injury and everyone will have a near-death experience.
Wonderful. Yeah. Really selling the sport.
What would you say to your... Like, are your kids interested in it? Have they showed any interest?
They are. They're watching.
Good morning. Two girls, right?
No, boy and a girl. Kai and Ella. Yeah, they're into surfing. You know, I'm not pushing them, but if they take to it, they're really good in the sea at the moment, but I don't want to be one of those pushy dads. So they play football and do all the rest of the stuff. So
okay, you're not exactly in a position to say no, you can't do
no,
given the life you've lived.
Yeah, they can do whatever they want, really.
It's an incredible rig. Cold Water Eden is the name of the book. Has your perspective changed since you've had kids? Like, would you be inclined to... Like, do you still go out and chase the big waves?
No, absolutely. When my daughter was born in Sligo General Hospital and then my son later, it changed something in my DNA. Yeah. I just have no desire to risk life and limb anymore. I'm so into my kids. I want to be there for them always. I know that sounds very dramatic, but, you know, I did sat down and wrote a book rather than go chasing 50-foot
waves.
That's it,
yeah. It's a little bit drier anyway.
Yeah.
And probably a tiny little bit safer as well.
Yes.
And what is the surf scene in Ireland?
It's fantastic at the moment. It's vibrant. It's ever-changing, you know, to try and pigeonhole it into one thing. So the surf scene in Ireland, I guess, from Tremor around to Port Rush, and even you get surfers on the east coast of Ireland. So, you know, it's a fantastic, vibrant scene. Get into it.
Oh, I'm excited for you.
Once I finish the book, I've read most of it at this stage, Cold Water Eden. Richie Fitzgerald, thanks so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much. Much appreciated. For more from Richie, check out his interview with Tom Dunn on What's the Story, sponsored by Eason, which will be on the Virgin Media Player now.
Let's take a quick break. We'll be back with you just after this.
Coming up, winner of Great British Bake Off, Nadiya Hussain, will be joining us, so do not go anywhere.
The Great Pink Run with Glanbia is back this year and takes place in Dublin on the 9th of October and Kilkenny on the 16th of October, and participants can take part virtually. To raise awareness, we've teamed up with Breast Cancer Ireland and have 7 brand new Fitbits to give away. This event is open to everyone of all ages and fitness levels, with 10k and 5k options on the day. Breast Cancer Ireland guarantees a fun family day out with music, games and children's entertainment, along with festival-style food, ensuring entertainment for all the family. Registration is at greatpinkrun.ie. All proceeds raised will support Breast Cancer Ireland's research. To be in with a chance to win, simply answer this question. What is the distance of a full marathon? Is it A, 26.2 miles, or B, 46 miles? To enter, call 1550 999 333 or text PRIZE to 57199.
Now, our next guest captured the hearts of everyone when she won the Great British Bake Off back in 2015. Since then, she's made cake for royalty, written 10 cookbooks, fronted her own TV shows, released a best-selling memoir, and the list goes on.
Now, the one and only Nadiya Hussain joins us now to chat about her brand new book, Nadiya's Everyday Baking, and here is a sneak peek of her making one of her delicious recipes.
Come on, get the roast out of the oven. Look. The recipe is so simple, but it's the little things where that kimchi's just peeking out and you can see that colour. And, you know, colour means flavour, and this is bursting with it. Grab that chicken. That is not just a feast for your mouth, but that is a feast for your eyes. Goodbye, I am off to have my lunch.
Ain't got no sunshine, ain't got no rain.
Those flavor combinations take the humble roast to not just delicious, but stratospheric. You are going to love this.
Nadiya, it is so lovely to have you talking to us today on the show, I have to say. And that looks absolutely delicious. It's one of many amazing recipes you've made over the years, recipes you've created even. But this new book is about baking in the oven. Is it true that you didn't use an oven until you're 12?
Well, yes, not till I went to school, because I grew up in a house where it was all stovetop cooking. So I didn't actually ever use the oven as a child. I didn't grow up with a grandma and a mum who baked. And it was only really when I went to high school and did food studies where my teacher was mixing eggs and flour. And I was like, that is not how you make an omelette. What is she doing? And then she turns on the oven. And I was like, she's turning the cupboard on, because my mum used to use it for storage. And so I thought she was, I did not know that that was the oven. And there, and it, honestly, there's that moment when you smell butter and sugar and flour and eggs, and you just, I felt like a child, like that smell, and it was magical. And I suppose that magic never left.
The book is gorgeous, Nadiya's Everyday Baking, but it's not just baking. Well, baking, when we think baking, we think cake, and when we think of you, we think cake. And and then you put a chicken like that in front of us at 9:20 in the morning, for crying out loud, on a Friday morning, Nadiya, come on. But I generally more go for the savoury recipes. And I suppose there's something for everyone. I mean, whether you want to bake a cake, something sweet for an occasion, or for the dinner, you've covered it all.
Absolutely. I think sometimes when you think baking, it's kind of, I think people naturally kind of steer towards cake and baking biscuits and sweet things. And that is not, I mean, it's an entire piece of kit that is so powerful and so wonderful. It can pretty much do anything. And I've proved that, because there are recipes for pasta, noodles, rice, even, I'm going to say it, potato cakes. In the oven.
We love potato cakes. Yeah, we're exactly. Big on potato cakes in Ireland. But you're doing them in the oven, which is an interesting twist.
Yes,
indeed. And
yes.
But can anyone use... This is going to sound ridiculous, because I know, Ray, we've had this discussion earlier on, that everybody can cook. I wouldn't be great at cooking now, but if it's, is it easier to actually not messing something up if you're cooking it in the oven? Because there's not too many elements at play once it's in there.
Yeah, I think what happens with the stovetop cooking, if you're anything like me, like what starts off with sort of half an hour in the kitchen ends up with being 4 hours and about 16 dishes. And that's kind of, it's a little bit more, you can be a bit more fluid. Whereas with the oven, what I love about baking, what I really wanted to kind of allow people to enjoy was the fact that when you put a timer on, you know, when the recipe says 45 minutes, you put the timer on, 45 minutes, in it goes, you can go off, run a bath, come back, take it out, done. Like, there's no thinking involved. So for anyone who's a little bit nervous about cooking, I think it's a really good place to start.
I suppose when there's no thinking involved with something like that, so you say, but you've had to, in the past, think quite a lot about what you're doing. Of course, I have to talk about Bake Off. Probably the best-known face to come out of Bake Off is your own. What was the pressure like and trying to come up with these amazing creations that you had? Because my stress levels watching it were not great. I can only imagine what you went through.
Isn't it funny how it's such a quaint little show of baking, you know, amateurs baking in a tent, and it puts so much pressure. And it is, the pressure you feel is 10 times worse when you're in there, because you literally have sort of 5 days to think about what you want to do next. And then you've got 5 days to practice before you go into the tent in the weekend. And I was like a woman deranged. I would practice day and night. I would day and night. And I think the pressure shows in the tent, but it is one of the best experiences of my life, for sure.
Oh, absolutely. God. And you know what? It brought you to us. Your company is, you're just so warm, and it's lovely. Even in the bit where you're just cooking and eating chicken, it's just a gorgeous, yeah. It's lovely to be engaged in it and lovely to join you while you're enjoying the chicken. It's always on our screens. It's back on at the moment. Do you watch it, and does it give you PTSD?
It's the song. It's the music at the beginning. You know, it's the music at the beginning that gets me. I'm like, oh my goodness, because Paul would play the music in the tent while we were filming, just to get us to get us stressed out. But it's the music. But I haven't actually, over the last couple of years, I haven't been able to watch it because I've been so, so busy. But I do keep an eye on social media and see what's happening as new people come out of the tent, I suppose. So yeah, it's always interesting to watch what's happening. But like I said, you know, the show was a very different beast when I was in it. It's changed so much over the last 7 years.
Yeah. But you've become hugely successful since that. I mean, people who've never watched Bake Off know who you are now because of your TV shows, you've had books out. And looking back on your experience there, do you think you were prepared for the level of exposure and the level of love that was thrown at you afterwards? Because you're a household name now.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Nothing can really prepare you for what comes after Bake Off. And I suppose for me, I'd in the past seen people come off Bake Off and not really seen anyone with a career that come out of it and had a career. And I didn't expect it and I didn't want it. And it was one of those things that it just happened. It was a very serendipitous situation for me. And it was kind of like, do I, don't I? And I've been very lucky in that, you know, I've had some amazing opportunities, but I love what I do. I love writing, I love cooking, I love sharing my recipes with people. So ultimately, I'm doing something that I love. And so it doesn't really feel like a job. I have pinch me moments, but it doesn't feel like work. I mean, my son said to me not long ago, why are you still famous?
Out of the mouths of babes. The brutal honesty of your children. I suppose that's the thing that's so infectious about you. You can clearly see that you enjoy it. There's always talk about, you know, particularly with the evolution of Bake Off, with the move of channels and change of presenters, there's always a talk of, like, who are the judges? Are the judges going to change? Would you ever consider going back on Bake Off as a judge?
I've been asked, but you never know.
But would you?
I never know.
Would you? Say yes, and then we'll hook you up with the right people.
Would I? I might.
Right, okay. That's enough. We'll watch this space then. Because, yeah, there could be changes. Because this is the show that's going to last forever. So the show will go on and on.
Yeah, so, we'll be gone and Bake Off will still be here.
Yeah, we'll hold you to an I might then.
I do have to ask you one question before I leave you go. I mean, you've experimented quite a lot in this cookbook, of course, before you came up with your recipes and in the past. what's the most disgusting thing you ever made? Have you ever made a recipe and cooked it and gone, oh, this has not worked at all. This is not what I expected.
Yeah, absolutely. While I was doing Bake Off, I was very experimental and I did a white chocolate and lavender bavoir. And I there's a point when lavender becomes too much and it becomes like potpourri in your mouth. And my son tried it and he put it in his mouth and he said, don't ever make me put something like that in my mouth ever again.
Again. The brutal honesty that you come to depend on from your family. On our to-do list is the chili chicken rice with charred broad beans from the book. There's no photograph. The photographs generally are gorgeous. There's no photograph for that one. So I'll take a photograph and I'll send it to you. You can stick it in the next book.
No, please. What's
your own favourite from Nadia's Everyday Baking, Nadia?
Oh, I think for me, it's probably like the cookie pie is an absolute favourite because it's like it's basically like architecture. It's this huge pie made out of cookie dough. Okay. And it's one of our favourites and my kids absolutely love it. And probably breakfast pizza.
What'd you say?
Breakfast pizza, my friend.
Now you're talking my language.
Funny enough,
we've got a food truck outside doing us pizza in just a few minutes. I'll send you another photograph. I'll send you that one as well. Nadia, it's beautiful. It's absolutely gorgeous. And gorgeous to talk to you as always. Nadia's Everyday Baking in your bookshops now. Nadia, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure talking to you. And, of course, you can see Nadia's new show on Wednesdays on BBC Two at 8:30 p.m.
Up next, we've got more great looks for winter in fashion.
And there's no question there's a bit of a nip in the air recently.
So what better time to get looking for a new coat? Stylist Laura Jordan is back with three more great options for us this morning. It definitely is that transitional time in terms of coats that you kind of, before you were like, I don't think I need it, whereas now you're like,
it's freezing.
It?
Yeah.
Exactly. And it's a quick, mad panic because the weather tends to change fast.
Like that. Yeah.
Yes. And we find at this time of the year, the best selection is available now and in the next few weeks. So even if you're not buying something heavy, you know, to say, I don't need it yet, when you do need it and you do want it, the selection just mightn't be quite as, you know, as enhanced Abundant. Or as, yeah, yeah, as you would love. So get in there early with a coat is my top tip.
OK, right. So what are we going for?
So we're starting with something very elegant. And again, we mentioned earlier, the idea of having your coat as part of your outfit instead of that thing you put on before you go out the door, covering up the investments you've made in other areas. So this is a really chic, classic, elegant piece that is, I suppose, timeless is the best description of it. So it has single-breasted, it's got a beautiful collar on it, fits nicely on the shoulders and just goes down to that mid-length. So this with your black, your taupe, your biscuit, your cream, all those beautiful warm neutrals, and then some pastels like a light blue, a cashmere jumper even under that would be gorgeous. This is from Durbin's again in Loughrea with a great selection of coats and indeed general outfit and for men and women. Then we have our glasses. So again, I love a sunglass in winter. And I know it, at the moment it's handy because you're, you know, if it's low sun or it's a cold day, sometimes those things pair together. These are a Gucci frames. They are a new piece available through Mullingar Opticians. These are also from the new collection of Betty and Biddy. And that got that black stone in the earring pulls in through the stripes and the pattern in the jumper and coat. So this jumper here is a really easy fall. It's just a cozy, scrunchy almost feel to it. And I think oversize works and something a bit more relaxed in the fit when you've got a leather effect trouser. Yeah.
But what about the stripes, the horizontal stripes?
Absolutely.
Sometimes they're a bit controversial.
Absolutely.
You're toe shy away from them, but they look lovely there.
If you do them that are a bit loose, size up in an oversize, size up in a stripe is always my advice. It's when you go and they're tight on you, the stripe just makes it, you know, bigger than you are. So that's definitely top tip. And a small stripe. See the way there's like a narrow little stripe in that is helpful as well. The trousers also, that's sleekness, so that contrast we talked about earlier on, and important when you're putting together lots of layers is the contrast, or I likes it. And similarly with the pop of colour, the colour contrasting to the simple cream and black kind of classic piece. This again is a structure bag here from Jeremiah Higgins. So all of that pulls together season to season. It isn't something that's going to be highly trend. We saw a couple of highly trend pieces earlier, but this is for someone who says, I don't really like shopping in that way. And some delicate details there from Betty and Biddy, again, all available through their website. Now, the shoe boot we had in navy earlier on, this is a black version. And instead of cutting underneath the ankle bone, this cuts down the front of the foot and is equally flattering.
Suede as well, is it?
It's exactly, suede finish and a tiny bit of leather patent at the top. I'd wear these with a trainer sock
if you're wearing a pair of trousers or jeans with them. And then obviously they're great with black tights and a dress or skirt too. So this is, again, as we talked about earlier, that you just mentioned, that is it, do I need a coat?
Yes. A shacket.
Or do I need something between? It is indeed, yes.
Oh, I get it right. I'm learning. Still learning.
So again, I'm always afraid to say that word.
Yeah, I know.
It goes any which way for me.
You don't know which way, exactly. So this, again, just beautifully collared. So if you are going to wear a shacket, you want to make sure it's got a bit of sharpness at the top, which is that nice collar through it, and the single buttons down through the front. Also, there is pockets on this at the bust area, but they are not buttons. You don't want a button at that point. Just let it flow right down. You could button it up and have it as a closed coat style. I've kind of kept this a bit more relaxed, primarily so we can see the items underneath it. Again, what goes with this, your khaki, your taupe, your beige, your white, and all those even denim pieces will work in nicely with it. Earrings, again, just to have a little bit of detail. That, again, the idea, I love a statement earring with a chunky knit.
Earrings.
It seems like, you know, a lot of people say, can you only wear those at nighttime? No, they're beautiful during the day if you have texture with them.
Okay.
So if you have something very sleek and tight, it doesn't look great, but texture, again, the contrast of the sparkle with the chunky matte fabric of a knit. And then the necklace as well that blends with it. This is a sleeveless ribbed knit, which is really handy for tucking in and as a layer under, but to note, it is sleeveless for anyone who wants to know how that actually finishes and all available on the On Trend site. These are an alternative to this tighter, sleeker trousers Audrey was wearing a minute ago. If you say, I don't want something super tight, because it just depends on your own personal body shape and preference. These are a bit looser and wider and have the cargo finish with the pocket on the side. And then the bag, again, that structured piece from Jeremiah Higgins, and the watch also from Fields Jewellers in any of their many stores nationwide.
Is there anybody who should stay away from like a print, especially like in a shacket like that? Like, is it...
And you know what's a question I was asked recently? If you're petite, and you wear something
that... look a bit too...
If you do, you need to have contrast.
Okay.
And then, you know, the shoe giving the ankle there. So you can give, like, the foot, the gentle contrast of the bulk. Our eye likes it. So even, you know, your green jacket with the white underneath it, it's one pop. Don't have a contrast in where your eye goes. Just have it really sleek and easy.
And then my eye goes...
There we go, your eye goes.
Straight to the Barbie pink.
Oh, listen... If it's Pepto-Bismol pink, I'm in.
This is what I like to consider if we have a day where we go, I actually need a warm puffer coat, but I'm not compromising on fun.
I've never seen one of that colour before.
It is
in my
remarkable because
it's a finish on it.
Exactly, it's a satin sheen finish on it. This is from Carrigdon, available in all of their stores and through their website. So there's click and collect as well if you want to use it that way and just have it in the store, because I reckon this is going to be a popular option. It's so bright statement and go. And again, it's got a bit of polish in terms of the tailoring, which you'll see in a second. The glasses with it, again, that slightly sporty look available from Mullingar Opticians and in their store in Enfield. And the earrings, simple. So we just, because you've got the bright coat, we want to pair it back, just the simple diamante huggy hoop there, and the double layered necklace, which is beautiful with a fine knit. So really simple, delicate and easy. And this knit here has beautiful texturing on and design on the sleeves. I like when the texture goes in the bottom half of the arm, because we're usually happier with that part of our arm rather than the top half. When we start putting holes and gaps up there, it's a bit more difficult. So really simple in that white colour, which really lifts the pink. And that would be good tucked in with a high-waisted trouser or skirt as well. It's quite a versatile piece in that jumper there. The jeans, simple and easy. So again, we've rolled them up a small bit to show off the trainer, which we'll see in a second, but that lean finish, that indigo, works nicely with the pink. And for people on the go, that bag, again, the Gianni underneath the coat, just kind of rather than bulking it even more. So bag underneath a puffer coat is a handy tip as well, rather than trying to, you know, it's all bulking you otherwise if you're bringing the eye out with the layers. And then really simple and easy then with the rest of the jewellery on it, keeping it dainty compared to the contrast of the bulk. And these trainers have a platform for a little bit of height.
Very lovely,
that pewter
actually.
Finish. Yeah, they, you know, they're more realistic than the white trainer, I think, coming into autumn, winter, to have something with a slightly darker colour, which still packs a punch.
Because we have too many puddles in this country for autumn, winter and
you
white
said
trainers.
It. All I can think of is coat. I need coat. That's honestly all I can think of. After the break, I may be wearing that coat. We're heading out to sample some grub. We'll see it in just a couple of moments. It's just so pink, and I need it a lot in my life.
Do you know someone who should be crowned an inspirational county hero? Together with Gala Retail, we're celebrating the achievements of others whose incredible efforts have had a real impact on our communities. Gala is gifting 26 county heroes with hotel stays worth €1,000 for every winner, be it the local charity fundraiser or sporting volunteer. We want to hear about your inspirational county hero. To nominate, simply tell us why they are so special in under 200 words on gala.ie/inspiration awards by Sunday the 2nd of October.
You're very welcome back. Look at this lovely, glorious weather. Just in time for food. It seems like everyone has a food truck these days, and Ireland's now full of travelling vans serving some seriously tasty grub.
We're joined by three of Ireland's best food trucks. So let's start with the Osprey Hotel.
Abby's over
here.
Come on. Abby, how are you, sir?
This is fabulous, Abby, for starters.
What
a truck. What have we got on offer this morning, tell me?
I got our one of the Osprey favorite dish. It's called authentic butter chicken.
Butter chicken.
And saffron scented rice with the mini coriander naan. And this was one of the favorites.
I'm allowed to use this. Sorry.
And we put this in the original bar menu.
Yeah.
It's going very well in the weddings and event.
Yeah.
And we're offering in the taste of Kildare kind of food, butter chicken from India and the Moroccan lamb tagine from Morocco and the pork tacos from the Mexican.
Oh, beautiful. This is a taste of Kildare all weekend.
Yeah.
Okay.
Tell me this. What is the reaction being to the food trucks? I mean, I think it just adds a little bit. Go on, Ray, do it. It adds a little bit of something. It's like, it looks so impressive.
It's little different. Like while working in the kitchen and you work in the food truck, you have more interaction with the customers. And you feel the state of response about the food.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's my prediction. And it's much quicker food and much nicer. And just like, I think most of the food trucks nowadays, they start doing the health and well-being options and low calories. Yeah, that's good, you know.
And tell us,
like food trucks is not about the burger and pizzas, but about every food, you know.
Absolutely, there's an array in every different type.
You're going for different options there. It's good to get a mix, good to get a variety. We'll certainly try and check you out this weekend. What's your own favorite?
This is my favorite. This is my
the butter chicken.
My favorite, my family favorite, my friend's favorite, Osprey favorite.
I think everybody's favorite.
Amazing.
My favorite.
Absolutely
already,
yeah. Amazing. Yeah. Is it what are you into? Is this your type of food, right? Like,
absolutely,
as in, do you,
yeah,
like,
just,
obviously, we have a little. I know you just got to ate it. You're on the telly, right? You know, you're a pro. You always do.
Yeah.
But in terms of taste and flavour, is that like butter creamy? I mean, I know it's not,
yeah,
but
it's
it smells incredible. I will have a bit of that, but I'm just. He's not going to say anything but be aware. It
fabulous,
is, like,
yeah.
In fairness.
All
absolutely
right.
Gorgeous.
Let's go and check
Abby,
out Graw
no
Pizza.
Problem,
come on, Abby,
enjoy.
Pleasure to
have
meet you.
Have a brilliant weekend.
Cheers,
and say hi to everybody in Osprey
for
us, won't you?
Pizza for breakfast. We were talking to Nadiya Hussain earlier on about pizza. I'll step over this side.
Ryan, what's the crack?
Hello, sir.
Things, how are you?
Good.
What have you got for us? Pizza for breakfast.
Yeah, pizza for. No better place.
Gorgeous.
This is the Seamatini.
Oh.
So it's like chorizo and andouille. So it's like a kind of spicy Calabrian sausage.
Why Seamatini? And what's this association with spicy sausage?
Well, he came down and visited. No,
he didn't. He loves a pizza.
Yeah, he does. Yeah.
So Seamus.
I just love like Irish history and stuff. So all my pizzas are named after. So I have like the James Joyce, the Luke Kelly,
oh, nice.
Constance Markovich, Mary Robinson. So.
The Ray Foley.
Yeah.
I tell you what, I'm going to eat enough of it. It's going to be named after me. You're going to put my name on the side of the
yeah.
truck. So this is the Seamus Heaney. What other varieties do you have?
So this is just the Mary Robinson, which is the margarita. So it's just fior de latte mozzarella, mm-hmm. tomatoes, grana padano, basil. And then like each week I do like a special. So like last week I had like porchetta and salsa verde and stuff. So
what was that called?
Change up. Just call it
no
special.
Name.
Just
no name. The Mayor of Robinson, definitely very presidential.
In New York for a little bit, right?
So,
like, in fairness, New York pizza obviously is some of the best in the world.
Yeah, so I actually just lived there for a while, so I went around traveling.
He's like, I didn't work.
Right, I didn't work.
For pizza purposes, I did not work.
In case the US ends here after.
Yeah. I'm just after, I've still got the taste. Can I mix the taste? The Indian was absolutely gorgeous, the butter chicken over at Abby's there. Check that out. Isn't that gorgeous? It looks absolutely fabulous.
Nice. Over there.
So can I mix the flavors?
You if can,
give
of
course. Tell us
some.
Now. Here's the other. Do you have a situation where you don't cut the pizzas, or is it not the done thing to cut it?
No, I'd cut it because people are going to eat it. The only time people don't cut it is if they want to reheat at home because it's easier to put into the oven. But
right.
No, I'd always
cut
it.
Knife and fork on pizza, yay or nay? I like a knife and fork. Now for fancy pizza like yourself, Ryan, in fairness, I do.
No, you're done.
Yeah. You'll
probably need a napkin.
Go on, let your lunchbox. I'll tell you what, I'll leave this here.
Pineapple, yes or no on pizza?
Am I eating everything? Are you going to eat anything at all?
Well, listen, you're here for those purposes. Just,
I'm here for the shot of your man stuffing his face with grub.
Absolutely.
So you're going to be at Taste of Kildare as well?
I am, yeah.
For the weekend.
Head down after this. So.
And what's your what is your most popular pizza?
What's I'd say this one is. Right. So,
Seamus.
Yeah, right, and like I make my own hot honey. Would you like some too?
I'm going to have one now in a second, yeah, but cool. For the purposes
hot
of talking.
Honey?
Hot honey, yeah. Oh. So like honey infused with habaneros and stuff, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's kind of a sweet...
Who do you try them out on, Ryan?
Everyone and anyone. So yeah. If a delivery man rocks up and he's in time for pizza, I'll give it to him. But yeah,
there's
a lot of friends.
On that.
There is, yeah.
Oh, you can taste
so,
it.
So, yeah, so I just kind of... I try them out on friends and anyone that's around, so no one will say no to a pizza.
Tell you what.
Absolutely. Well, listen, have a brilliant weekend.
Right. Thank you so much.
I'm your friend now.
Good. Call okay.
Me. We'll check out one more. Thank you.
Got Ginger's barbecue. Hello, Ginger.
Morning.
You're the Ginger.
I am indeed.
Right.
Morning, Nathan. Sir? How are you?
I'm Nathan Diamond.
Nathan, how are you? Right, so what have you got for us?
I've still got the pizza. Today we've got two of the dishes we're going to be serving this weekend. So this is a chicken kariagi slider.
Wow.
It's chicken marinated in soy, sake, ginger and garlic, rolled in potato flour, fried till it's crispy, served with a miso mayo and a raw vegetable slaw. This is the reason we started the business. It's smoked beef, so it's been smoked for 12 hours. Triple garlic mayonnaise, crispy onions and yellow chilli sauce in a chipotle bun.
Nathan, you did like fine dining was your kind of thing in terms of restaurant background. Yeah. How do you go? And not that there's anything wrong with food trucks, because obviously, as we can see, it's just incredible
it's an
food.
Explosion,
but how
yeah.
do you, was it the pandemic or what was it? Or was it to make these creations?
During the pandemic, so I started a business with a man and we had a truck as part of it. We were feeding the race courses. So every Saturday I started Ginger's Barbecue at the truck.
Okay. Yeah.
And I loved it, and I kind of saw the potential. I was spending more time with my family, and I just went, I don't want to go back to what we were doing before. And I just, like, I have so much time. Even though I'd be working around where we do the prep at home, the children are always there. I can have lunch, I can have breakfast, I can have dinner, and
she's
that's
creeping.
The...
She's creeping.
Look, she's in.
I'm
after sneaking in.
That's the reason we kept going.
We did it.
But you know what?
Sharing is caring, lads. Sharing is caring.
Is this level hard, like, in terms of preparation-wise, for the food? Because obviously we saw Ali over with the Osprey Hotel there in terms of, like, making curries and kormas and stuff. Or is it just kind of par for the course that if you're talented like you guys, that we'll see across the weekend, it's just like, doesn't matter.
It's hard work. You spend a lot of time prepping and working. You spend a lot of time cleaning. It's hard work and passion. And like, if you love it, you'll do something that people will taste the difference. Sometimes people come up and think you're just a chip van. We're not just a chip van.
Really digging into this now. I'm sorry. We need to take a shot of this.
That's smoked, is it? Yeah.
Absolutely.
Gorgeous.
If you'd like to sample any of these food trucks yourself, all three will be at Taste of Kildare this weekend. Mm. I might as well go because I haven't gotten any yet this morning. And tickets are available at tasteofkildare.ie. Coming up tomorrow, of course, we'll be looking ahead to the cost of living protests happening in the capital this weekend.
Tony-nominated actor Catherine Gallagher will be discussing her role in the mega hit You.
And we talked to the stars of the brand new film In From the Side on Century's inclusion rugby team.
Plus, if you ever wondered what your pet was thinking, a professional pet psychic will be reading the minds of our pets.
Rawr. All that and your news, your sport, your weather and all you're waking up to. I'm taking pizza and beef home. We're back tomorrow from 9 o'clock. Have a lovely day.
Take care.
Get yourself down this weekend. You need to get down this weekend. Wow.